you rung up.
Yeah.
My first question is an obvious one. What made you want to actually be in a band? And was that a sort of childhood thing? Or?
I guess you see other people, you like music, you know, from a young age, perhaps. I remember we had friends that used to come round to the house and play like skiffle tunes, and my mum and dad would join in and we'd all join in. And I used to think, that'd be great to be able to do that, you know, give people that kind of enjoyment. And at that time, you're too young, you're 10, 9, 10, so you're not thinking of adulation, that kind of thing. But then that kind of takes over once you hit your grammar school. You then realise that this isn't a bad way to meet women either. So at about the age of 13, when I really started to play seriously, it wasn't a bad thing to be in a band. And especially I think guitars especially have got a quality like cars, like, you know, they're a very tactile thing. They're the shapes, you know, it's a fantastic instrument to just sits right in with the body. It's you look at the guy with the guitar and you go, I wouldn't mind being like that. But it then goes deeper, you know, you love playing, so, you know, it then becomes, you know, what you do. But I guess, you know, the original thing was that you've got to like music, number one, and then number two, the trappings that come with it afterwards.
That suggests that you actually wanted to be famous, not just successful, but famous.
I was a sportsman, believe it or not, when I was at school. I was actually quite a good soccer player, not that great at cricket because that ball was a bit hard. But once I'd grown my hair, I wasn't allowed to play for the school, so, you know, something else had to take over. I suddenly realised that there are no shortcuts in life, but if there was, then sportsmanship and musicianship, perhaps, or all I knew is that the drudgery of a 9-to-5 job really wasn't what I wanted to do, even though I perhaps had the intelligence to do other things. You know, my maths was always quite good. I guess fame then becomes, you have to look at that from two angles. If you want to be famous, your privacy goes. To try and get the balance between trying to remain a little private and having fame, now that's the difficult blend. But I guess the bottom line is that yes, I was looking to try and make my mark, let's put it that way.
As a young lad, you wouldn't think about the downside of it, would you? You think probably it'd be great to be out there.
I remember my father trying to dissuade me. I was working in a bank, because that was probably the best job that I could find at the age of something like 17, when I'd just left school. The bank seemed to be good wage. They didn't work Saturdays. You got off at 4 in the afternoon, so you could always do your gigs in the evening. Until I was in a band that kind of put the kibosh on that, because we started to do rather well. And then Monday mornings were difficult, and then Fridays used to disappear. And I remember my father really trying to dissuade me, are you sure this is what you want to do? And I said, yes, this is exactly what I want to do. I wanted to try and become a professional musician.
At what point did you get involved with Sweet? Let's just jump forward a bit. How did that come about? And where were they at that time?
I was in a band called The Elastic Band, and Sweet were doing the same kind of taped radio shows, or there was a thing called the Radio One Club, which used to travel about the country. And I kept hearing, you know, them doing things the same as we were. The Elastic Band at that time were rather a progressive band. but we were making commercial singles because, once again, the fame angle, we wanted to hire, you know, raise our profile, you know, become better known. And one surefire way was to try and, you know, try and have some kind of hit single material rather than just burying your head into the progressive Yes type rock that we were into. I'd then moved to London because the Acid Band had split up, and I was looking to do something because the band that I was in was, you know, was not doing anything. I was living in a bedsit in Shepherd's Bush with my brother, who was the bass player in the Elastic Band, and we were looking to try and get a gig together, but we soon realized that they don't come along every day, so we decided that we have to look in separate areas. And almost one of the first adverts that I saw in the Melody Maker was for Sweet. I saw two bands the same day. I didn't get to audition with the first band. I won't even mention who they are because they were quite well known, but I don't think they knew where they wanted to go either. And I walked into the Sweet audition, if you like, and I guess I must have been the one that was different, the one that was at least raring to go. And I don't remember Brian actually being at the audition. It was it was Mike Chapman who was like being the schoolmaster, if you like, and getting everybody in and out. And I remember Steve was almost asleep with his bass gear, and Mick and I had a little chat, and we played a couple of things, and well, you know, that was that. I believe there was a second audition only because a couple of guys couldn't make the first one, and I got called back to the second one, and this was in a huge deserted warehouse, and I think it was because I took along to the second audition a book that a friend had lent me of, well, really weird things in there. It was like there was a section on like freaks and freak shows in America and things like that. And later, I remember Mick saying to me, I think it was the book that, you know, that got you the gig, sort of thing.
And what level was Sweet at the time? What were they doing? Where were they at? Why did they want you? Why did they need a guitarist? And where was their career at that point?
That's a difficult one. I don't think they'd been doing a lot of live work, whereas I had. Because one of my first concerns was I wanted to get into a band that played live, because that's the ultimate. You know, you start out that way, and I'm finishing up that way. You know, I'm a player, I need a band, you know. I think they had got to a point, even though they hadn't been together too long, where they'd made a bit of an inroad and made a name for themselves, but it was gonna take something a little special to get it off the ground. And I think that something special was the fact that they'd reconnected with Phil Wainman, the record producer, and that he knew Nicky Chinn and Mike Chapman, who had some songs. And I don't think the original idea was for the Sweet to be the Chinn and Chapman songs. It was the fact that the Sweet were able to do the demos, especially the vocal side of it, to get everything into shape. And I walked into a situation that was almost settled, if you like, and there was one little piece of a jigsaw, or a couple of pieces of the jigsaw that were missing, and I guess I fitted it.
Let's who were Chinn and Chapman? Where were they coming from?
When I first joined the Sweet, I didn't really know anything about Nicky Chinn and Mike Chapman. I'd met Mike Chapman because he was in a band called Tangerine Peel. He was the lead singer, and he used to get a lot of television shows. And because of the Elastic Band and things like that, if I hadn't really met him, we passed, you know, our paths had crossed, if you like. Nicky Chinn came from a very well-appointed family, and I'm really not sure whether it was what they wanted him to do, but it was what he wanted to do, you know. He really felt that, you know, the show business side of things was what he wanted. And I could relate to that, you know, because there's a lot of pressure from people, as I said earlier, that, you know, you don't want, you want the best for your offspring, if you like, and that's where my parents' concern were, and I guess that his were the same. We were all fairly youngish, even Phil, Nicky, Mike, and the band. You know, none of us were probably any more than, you know, mid to late 20s. I was only 20. I was probably the youngest, but when I heard the songs, even though, as I say, I'd been in bands that were a little more progressive, you can't deny that these songs were potential hits, and it was it was a fabulous opportunity to try and make something of yourself. And I think that every other member of the band, Brian, Mick and Steve, felt the same way.
What were your impressions of characters in the band when you first met them, their characters? How did that work out?
I think it's been a major player throughout, that the four of us were fairly different characters. I think Mick and myself were similar type characters. We could be a bit overboiled or, you know, get a little bit excited about things, or sometimes you'd stand up and say the wrong thing because you felt that strongly about it. Steve was always the catalyst. He really, you know, kept the whole thing even. You know, you need someone like that in a band. And the strange thing is, it can be the bass player. Brian, when I first joined the band, I mean, I'd never met anybody like him. I mean, he was out and about, meeting everybody, perfect frontman. You need people like this in your band. You've got to have someone who steps forward and takes hold of the PR side, the frontman image, you know. Talk to anybody, you know, tell them how great we are, you know, and it was absolutely, you know, superb. And those early days, even though maybe the music wasn't exactly what we all wanted, but the feeling within the band of going off and doing gigs and was extremely, extremely tight.
What was the band's role in those early Sweet singles? What was your sort of function in them?
Well, it's well documented, and it's to do with finance, and as it usually is, that the Sweet sang on the first three or four records and didn't play. I guess I understand, because I'm a professional, that these things have to happen. It was also a lot of things like this were happening in the music business. You had a team of players who made the right kind of, it had been going on in America for years anyway, but you had a team of players who make the sound, the backing track, and then you get the band to vocalize. Only thing was, Sweet were a little bit better and a little bit different, so that really shouldn't have been happening to a band like this. And as I said, this is why probably Mick and myself do get a little bit het up, but we had to say so. So we dragged Mike Chapman, we dragged Phil along to gigs to make sure that they could see what was going on here. We were doing lots and lots of shows where we were only performing the hit of the moment. We weren't performing the previous one because it didn't fit in the repertoire with all the other songs that we were performing. So I guess that Phil and his team of players, his session players, were gradually, you know, being pushed to one side. I kind of remember him saying something about, well, if you can do it in the time allotted, then I'll give it a go. And of course we did, and that's when the whole thing turned around, the image and everything.
What was Nicky Chinn's actual role in the partnership? What did he actually do?
It's quite difficult for me to completely analyse that, but I definitely saw him as a go-getter. In most songwriting partnerships, there is probably one who comes up with a lot of ideas and one who contributes maybe just important facets. But you still need, you both can't be fiery, moody songwriters, otherwise nothing to get done. One of you has to be up and at them, this is what we've just written, and the other one has to be the one who mulls over a few of the ideas. And I guess now you see Mike Chapman as the one who sat there, persevered with the three chords till he found something that worked. And I guess that not really knowing, but hearing a few things that I have, that I guess that Mike and Nicky collaborated more on the lyric than the actual musical content. And even more so when the band were more involved with the arrangement of the song and the playing, that even more things like arrangements fell on us. So, you know, the three, the producer, the songwriters and the band all start to contribute probably equally.
It's a dynamic sort of relationship.
That's right.
And was Phil tough on you in the studio?
Always. It's a lesson to be learned. I think it probably, when I produced in later years, it made me into a much better record producer, knowing that, I used to say to young bands, look, I've been this way, it's your money you're spending, always remember that. Don't think the record company or someone is giving you this, it's going into a book somewhere, and at the end of the day, there will be a price to pay, and that's one, you know, one thing. Studios cost money, let's use them as little as we possibly can.
So, and how did that work out with Phil and the suite at that
time? I think with Phil, we had a, because him being from a musical background, being a drummer, we certainly had more of an ally, if you like, from a point of view of understanding musical areas. So, you know, it was perfect, you know, for quite a while. I think it gets, though, familiarity breeds contempt, if you like. And down the line, there was always going to be a little bit of friction and things like that. But I can't always go along with a little bit of friction can bring out, you know, something better. You know, I think that working relationships, sometimes being yes men, can be wrong as well, but I don't think that out of the darkest moments come the best music.
At what point did you really, did you think, God, we really made it? What point in terms of records?
That's a really difficult question. I guess when you've had your first hit, wherever it is, and I believe it was in Holland, the very first record took off. To actually get on a plane and go and do a television show somewhere other than your home country was fantastic. You know, none of us had done this. The moment that I really remember is the blockbuster moment when we'd been number one now for quite a number of weeks, and we ended up having to go somewhere like the Seychelles or Hong Kong or somewhere like that, and our flight was the night off Top of the Pops. So we left the Top of the Pops studio and got onto a British Airways flight, still in our, virtually in our stage clothes and makeup and everything, and just seeing the shock on everybody's faces, you know, as we arrived. And baggage had been checked beforehand, so we just were sort of swished up in a limo and onto the plane, and you start to think, I suppose this does mean something.
How did it affect you personally? I mean,
hang on a minute.
Sure.
Oh, I felt that welling for a.
Yeah.
Can I have that back on the set?
I suppose that another way of asking that question, how did things change for you as a result of being successful?
I think we spoke earlier about, you know, fame and your privacy. you know, having no relationship. There was a point, and whether the decisions made are right ones or wrong ones, you know, your private life, you know, becomes a little bit turmoil, and your public life, if that's what you want to call it, or your life on the road becomes another kind of turmoil. So you come from one into another and back out again, only especially in some of the years in the centre of the 70s, the middle section of the 70s, I don't think I had any private life. I was with the band all the time. And you can be with tons of people and be on your own and be so alone in your mind. And I guess that's what we all went through. And looking back now, I can see why, you know, people get a little bit crazy from time to time and, you know, turn to things that they wouldn't dream of turning to. You know, it's a crazy old lifestyle, but all you can do from these experiences is learn. And if you don't, then you ain't going to survive in the future. And I guess, you know, not wishing to put too fine a point on it, you know, I hope I learned.
Along with that lifestyle, there are some benefits, I imagine. And what might they be?
I think it was a Labour government in the 70s, so we paid a bit of tax. I don't know what the benefit of that was. Yeah, I'm not sure about that one. The benefits are that, you know, I came from a working, lower middle class background. I would definitely say working, being up north, you know, coming from North Wales. At least our toilet was inside the house. So to at least attain and got to a position that we got to, whereby we all had very nice houses in Stockbroker Belt around London. I mean, I can't deny, you know, that wasn't, you know, wasn't a positive side. But in the end, it's got nothing to do with assets and money. It always comes down to here. How are you feeling? And I guess I'm probably more at peace now than I've ever been in my life. In the 70s, if somebody had asked me the direct question, oh, I'd have given you a load of blurb about how wonderful it all was. But really and truthfully, you know, it's a lot better now.
How about the lifestyle on the road? You've obviously got, there are pleasures to be had there too.
In America, when you're on the road for, I don't know, 6 months or whatever, you know, all kinds of things come your way, whether they're substances or rather more shapely things. I think you just have to be a little choosy, I think is the word. I used to find a lot of solace in writing. I was on the road, in writing songs. It was far better than, should we say, being the one that was still seen out and about at 7 in the morning. Although that used to happen, but you know, I used to make sure that I had an acoustic guitar in my room and a little tape deck. And if I hadn't, you imagine being on the road for 6 months and then someone says, you've got an album to make. Where are the ideas going to come from? They've got to come from somewhere. And if you don't have any time when you're on the road, then you've really, when you get off the road and you have that 3 weeks off, that 3 weeks is basically to routine some material to go into the studio. I think that certain temptations have certainly taken their toll on a lot of bands, possibly including our band. But I think I've come through it. You know, I don't think that there's any absolute lasting effect, but then we'll, you know, we'll see, won't we? I'm only 40 at the moment, so.
I suppose I was actually thinking about your fans, and there were lots of girls, and it must have been really strange to have suddenly been sort of run, people chasing up, women chasing after you. That's what I was sort of fishing for there, actually.
I knew you were. I suppose the worst moments of the fan hysteria bits were, I remember playing a gig in Scotland, the Apollo. We were one of the first bands to, oh God, they're not doing that again, are they?
Dropping bombs.
Yeah, no, the army practice around here, you know.
Oh, right.
Yeah. I'm surprised you haven't heard the field guns
we
going.
A bit earlier on. Yeah. We'll just persevere though.
Yeah?
So you're in Scotland?
Yeah, I remember being in Scotland, Glasgow Apollo, and it being a totally sold out show. In fact, so much so, I think there were as many people outside the venue as there were in. And when we came out of the show, they had police lining the streets. I remember we had two limos, and somehow as many girls got inside the limo as band members. And we're thinking, what are we going to do here? We've had to drive past this cordon of police. When we've got to a decent stretch of road, we've had to stop and let them out and then carry on to the hotel. But when we got to the hotel, there were as many people. They all knew where we were staying, crowded around the hotel, got into the hotel, checking up into the room. They're now staying in the hotel. So you can't get away from any of this, you know. And that was only the starting point. You know, it was even worse when we got to places like Scandinavia, where most of the female fans over there come from very well-to-do families. So they're basically, it's like a caravan following you around from gig to gig.
You make it sound like it's a terrible, terrible problem.
I guess when you're younger, it's fine. What I'm trying to be the way I think about it now, rather than the way I'm thinking about it then. I guess back then, all of us were probably a bit fill your boots. But now, I'm not saying I'm ashamed, I'm just a little reticent. It's not important. It's certainly not an important factor that I remember. You know, the music is still the important factor and always will be.
Do you think that the success or fame changed the other band members too? You've mentioned a few things that, and it's very similar to what Steve told me, actually, that you got often felt alone a lot of the time, even though he's always with people.
Yeah.
Did the others respond in a different way, do you think, to success and to the lifestyle that you were obliged to live?
I think we all went through it. You know, there were moments when one person was not excommunicated, but, you know, oh, it's my turn, okay, that's cool. It's his turn. It was never usually Steve's turn, though. Somehow, you know, Steve was always like a catalyst amongst it. But usually, you know, it all came back together. I think that and it's something that I can't really dwell on because, you know, it's not something that I actually went through, and I think you should talk to Brian about it. But I think that you know, it's quite well documented, his drinking days. He even admits he doesn't remember certain things himself. And why should he? You know, if you're having a brilliant time, why would you remember? But, you know, I guess, you know, I was a little silly as well by going in an opposite direction of trying to retain some kind of professional attitude instead of maybe looking for a more friendly approach, if you like. It's a very grey and very difficult area. It's not something that that now I ever really think about. You know, it's like an egg. It's been fried. You can't unfry it. So it's best to just let it run its course, and we'll see what comes out at the end. I'm a little, you know, concerned that, you know, certain newspaper articles and things like that have tried to, you know, create a bad feeling. There's never ever been any bad feeling as far as I'm concerned. Mine has always been a professional stance, it's always been a musical stance, it's never been anything personal. And, you know, I really wish that things had gone in a different direction and that possibly the band would still be together today.
Let's go back.
33 minutes.
Oh, we just changed that. It's got, I'm sort of jumping ahead a bit. We'll go back. Have you run up?
We've run up. We've got bars.
How did the image of the band develop? And who was the sort of moving spirit behind that?
We used to put kind of stage makeup on almost as soon as I joined the band. It just happened to be a routine that, I believe that, I'm trying to remember who it actually was. It may have even been, might have been Brian. You know, it was just a way of putting a bit of pan stick to, because when you're behind some lights, even though it's a rather primitive, you know, we're back to the days of loading your own gear in and putting a couple of Marshall columns either side of the stage for, you know, to perform. So we were used to at least doing that. When it got to doing television, then the Top of the Pops makeup department go a bit more overboard. They fill you out quite a lot and then you start having this done. And I remember Steve just having his eyes outlined, and it was all just slowly but surely, and it wasn't until a song like Little Willie that it kind of made a lot more sense, and it just happened. We'd seen Mark Bolan putting this little bit of reflection on his cheek, and we thought, well, it's definitely an area to go into, because they used to think we were puffs anyway. As I say, there was, the Brian's pretty boy image, Steve was a girl, and me and Mick were the ugly sisters, you know, the pantomime business. But it developed, and because we all had a different role to play, it worked, it really took off. I guess that we then became the one that people remember, and they think we spurred it all on, whereas I guess that Bowie and Bolan were there just a little ahead of all of this. But, you know, we used to put, you know, white and black on the nails and, you know, weird stuff that you could buy from, there's a shop called Bieber in Kensington, teardrops, you know, falling down your cheek. And
Steve ended up being like, it was like a transvestite, didn't he?
I've got photographs where people have said, you know, who don't really know that era, who's the girl in the band? You know, because, well, he looked like a woman, you know? So, there you go.
Looking back on it now, what was your wife make of it?
I really don't know what the hell she thinks of it, you know, being a little younger than me. I think she realises that it's, once again, she's a professional, so, you know, she believes in you do things for your professional reasons, and therefore, you know, why, what's wrong with that sort of thing? I don't think she'd like it to still be happening, but there you go.
How did the relationship with Chin and Chapman develop and then ultimately sort of change, probably for your benefit?
That's a difficult one, because Mike Chapman did go on to write a lot of songs, you know, good songs as well, after Sweet, and is still doing so for people like Tina Turner. But I understand your sentiment. At least, you know, the Sweet got to do what it wanted to do. I think that the Chin and Chapman thing was coming to a head, because I understand they have more songs than the Sweet can record, and the Sweet wouldn't want to still be recording, you know, the slightly more throwaway poppy things which other bands that they gave songs to. They will probably say that there were no rejections from Sweet that were given to other bands, but that is not essentially true. I remember you know, a couple of occasions where we heard another band doing a song that we had heard a, not a demo of, but Mike playing as an acoustic guitar version, and don't think that's the direction, you know. They were starting to spend time in America. I'm trying to remember the name of the band. I think it was Exile. They were working with this band in America. And they loved LA, so they kept going back there. And we hadn't yet quite experienced America. We'd had a one-off hit with Little Willie and never went to promote it, because when Little Willie was a hit in America, we had the Ballroom Blitz over here. So there was a year's difference. And in a year, we had moved on so far musically from Little Willie to Ballroom Blitz that we thought, if we go over there to promote that, then the new stuff that we've got and the new deal would kind of maybe fall apart. So we held off, but they were still in America and we wanted another single, we needed another single. And the record company had kept saying to us, because we had a good rapport with the A&R department, Fox on the Run, not the way you've done it on the album, but an edited down, more dynamic commercial version of Fox on the Run would be a hit. So I guess we kind of snuck into a studio and recorded it. And the studio that we chose was Ian Gillan's studio at Kingsway. Because, you know, we had a rapport with Deep Purple and, you know, we'd been to the studio when they were recording and things like that. So we snuck in there, did the job, and the record company loved it. And Gin and Chapman came back from America and were placed with this, not, it was a fait accompli, this is the next Sweet single. And I guess that's when, you know, a gap widened. I don't know how they completely felt, but they couldn't have not seen it coming. They must have, because they had so many times they were, when are you coming back? You know, because we'd just done a track, we'd done a couple of tracks with Mike after doing a couple of tracks with Phil in the same year, of which one had bombed in England, a song called Turn It Down, which was actually quite a big hit in Germany. So at least it kept us going somewhere. But they needed to come back from America in order for us to, to keep all the plates in the air. So we, as I said, we went in on our own, and it was the biggest selling single that we'd had, and probably still is.
And let's establish the background to that. There's a song that you've written yourselves. I'll just ask you.
Okay.
That's a statement.
Yeah, it was the biggest selling single to date, something that we had written ourselves, produced ourselves, and, you know, it was the band doing everything. And that was a first, and I think it showed in the production.
What were there frustrations in that relationship anyway? I mean, it seemed like Gin and Chapman had some kind of idea they were going to take over the world. And you were just like a part of their...
I think without the Sweet, and I don't want to sound like this, but I think without the Sweet, Nicky and Mike would have been successful, but maybe not then. I just don't know. You can't go back and you know, have a post-mortem over this, because we won't know. But my gut feeling is that it would have taken a little bit longer. Phil, the Sweet, Gin and Chapman, that was the catalyst that got the whole thing off the ground. When they started to work with people like Susie Quattro, and then later on they were just picking up bands like Mud and can't even remember some of the other bands, but they have to have outlets for all their material, but you still have to believe that we were here first and therefore, not the most important, but Smokey were in a completely different direction, but Susie Quattro, Mud and Sweet were in an eternal triangle in 1974, especially as they released three records, one after the other, leading up to Christmas, And on the first week of January in 1974, they had the top three records. Only problem was, ours wasn't the number one. Ours was just the number two.
To what extent did they control what you did and what you could record? I mean, I'm thinking before you started getting more confident in the studio yourself, but did you feel that control and not like it?
We sometimes felt that we might have a song that was a potential single, but it never got the debate as to whether it could have been. It was a foregone conclusion that they would be the writers, Phil would be the producer, and we would be the band. We used to write all the B-sides ourselves, but by then, the ideas for the B-sides were basically a four-way... I've got to stop again.
Sure, I'll stop there.
Yeah.
But you weren't able ever to have one of your own songs as a single, as an A-side single.
Yeah, I think it was fairly well cut and dried that Phil Wayman was the record producer, Gin and Chapman were the songwriters, and Sweet were the band. We used to write and sometimes even record our own B-sides. When I listen back to them, they've got a lot of energy and a lot of excitement, but sometimes they're a little manic and directionless because of the amount of time that we had to get them down onto tape. It wasn't until there was some structured song. It wasn't until there was some structured songwriting that we started to maybe come up with some ideas that were going to be potential singles. Once we had set that ball rolling with Fox on the Run, that's when you got problems, because you've started with a record that was number one in a lot of countries, number two in England, for 6 weeks, I think. Fox on the Run was number two. And I think it sold something like 3 million worldwide. You haven't half set yourself a goal now, because everything is now going to be measured by that one.
Were you slightly handicapped by the image that you had as well, do you think, in terms of trying to develop into a sort of more mature band?
For some reason, the Germans went with us. Wherever we wanted to do, they went with it. England still wants to put us in that little bag of goodies which include Gary Glitter. It's the only era that the Sweet ever were part of. Forget about the fact that, you know, we recorded songs like Love Is Like Oxygen and had an album like Level Headed. Forget all that. The only era that counts for them is somewhere between Little William Wigwam Bam and the Ballroom Blitz. I don't even think they recognise Fox on the Run. They still go back a little earlier and, you know, the blockbuster, the Camp Hitler on Top of the Pops, it's all they remember. I'm not decrying it, it's just a fact of life. So naturally, we look... that's yours, isn't it? So naturally, our horizons have to look wider than just one country.
Did you find it hard to take on the responsibility of writing your own material and producing it?
I'd always written songs ever since I was 14. I'd hate to listen to them now, the ones I wrote when I was 14. And sometimes I can't even bear to listen to the ideas that I proposed that the band should record 20-odd years ago. But songwriting is a very definitive art. You can't make it work all the time. Although there are some people who, every time they sit down, Elton John must be one of them, he comes out with a tune. And it's a good one, usually. So I'm afraid I'm not that prolific. The difficulty is that you've set yourself the starting point with Fox on the Run, and where do you go? What we actually did was we sat down and started to work on what we thought would be the most definitive Sweet single. This was just before Queen came out with Bohemian Rhapsody as well, where it was all going to it was going to have time signatures, weird, trying to make it within a 3.5 to 4 minute song to have this musical piece of excellence, where it would have the riffs, it would have everything that the Sweet, the vocal ideas, all the tricks, and we came up with Action. And a lot of people still feel that we achieved what we set out to do, and I guess they could be right.
See, I think that after you split from Chin and Chapman, you're obviously hungry again to achieve. At what point does your career as a four-piece start to falter a little?
I don't think America was a great deal of benefit if you're looking for something to hold the band together. If anything, it can be quite destructive. The pressures on the road in America are trebled. The availability of everything is trebled. The amount of crazies that you meet are trebled. The hotel situation, it was dream world. And I guess that if you want excess, you got it, especially in America. And I think that must have helped to contribute. It even caused friction between American representatives and European representatives. So what it did to the band, and these are professional managements, if it caused friction between them, imagine how the band are feeling. It was starting to become, it was good while it lasted, This was leading up to Lovers Like Oxygen. I guess we were having some success in America and in Germany and other parts of Europe, a little bit in Japan, a little bit in Australia, but living in our home country and having no success there. It makes everything come from left field a bit.
That's the perspective I'm talking from, I suppose, that in Britain you had episodic success with your own material, but it wasn't a consistent success.
No.
That song you just mentioned was obviously a big hit here too. After that song, was that when, just in terms of time, when the band started to sort of dissolve, you think, under the pressures you've mentioned?
It could have gone two ways, because we had Love Is Like Oxygen right at the end of the Level Headed album. It could have almost been left off the Level Headed album, which would have probably been a mistake, because I don't know whether we'd have had a hit with it after Brian had left the band. So it had to go on the Level Headed album. However, it probably made the whole situation even worse when Steve, Mick and myself separated from Brian after having such a musically innovative recording like Love Is Like Oxygen. It probably seemed to the outside world the most stupid thing to be doing. And when I look back, I would have thought that as well. But then I was part of it. So, I have to look upon it from a different perspective.
How did that come about, though, that you split? When you go into as much as little detail as you want, just from your perspective.
My memory of it, and you may well get four different memories on this point, is that probably the band would have stopped in 1970, end of 78, beginning of 79. if Brian hadn't separated from the situation. It could have happened years earlier when Mike Chapman was making noises to Steve Mick and myself to continue with the makeup. This was before Kiss, but go into a like a theatre. Oh, I've got to stop.
Okay, we'll pick up again on that. I'll ask you that question all over again, because you were going on to answer it in a way I wasn't quite expecting.
Mm.
How did the process happen? How did it come about that Brian left the band?
I think everybody who was involved at that time would give you a different answer to that question. My memory of it is that there wouldn't have been a band called Sweet in that late 78, beginning of 79 period if Brian hadn't separated. It had just got to that point where musically and things that were happening, I mean, the drinking, the, you know, the situation was, I suppose it was meant to be a little bit of shock treatment, but it became permanent. And I guess the news to a lot of people was quite devastating, especially after a song like Love Is Like Oxygen. Previously, though, quite a few years previously, especially after Mike Chapman had been to America, he was talking to Steve Mick and myself about separating from Brian. Brian continuing as like a pop singer with the, you know, the boy frontman image, and the Sweet taking off into the more rock orientated area that the music had taken, and us enhancing the makeup even further so that it became almost Rocky Horror Show, and this was before Kiss, and taking off in that direction. At that time, I remember all of us, to a man, basically thought that would be a really silly thing to do. You know, the band is the Sweet, and that's it. And so he mentioned it at the wrong time. However innovative and great his idea was, in hindsight, it may have been the answer to all the problems, but it didn't happen, so.
Yes, easy to say that now, I suppose.
Yeah.
Well, why do you think Brian did drink? I mean, you were close to him, and you must have, what was behind it? Was he lonely or bad? What was behind that?
I really can't answer that. You know, what makes a lot of people, you know, do a lot of things. I think we all have problems and we have to deal with them when we're in a band and when we're on the road, and personality clashes, it's over in an instant. I don't bear grudges, never have. I can't see the point, you know. It's such a negative thing, you know, thinking, oh, I hate him and I hate this, and, you know, you've got to get that out of your system and then move on, because otherwise it'll just eat and grind and it will always be there. I think that it had got to that point where I was finding it difficult, especially being the guy who was always in the recording studio coming up with the ideas for songs, things like this, that here was someone who was not willing to participate the way that we were participating. After all, it's what you start out doing. It is a profession. It's not a game. So when it's your turn to come and sing, come and sing. I know it may sound a little harsh, and, you know, I don't feel particularly good about it now, but that was the business that we were in. You know, we had to continue because we're musicians and we're a band called The Sweet.
Were there other factors going on in the band too that weren't helping your kind of work and everything else?
I don't think interdepartmental squabbles help either, where, you know, I remember spending an obscene amount of money in America one year, And I was told later that that's where all the songwriting money went, to support a tour of America. And I think it's a lesson that you learn rather quickly. It's something I would never do today. What you do stands up for itself. If it doesn't, keep your money in your pocket.
Was the last tour to America a difficult thing to go through, the last 3 years of a band together?
Well, we were now a three-piece suite, working with a keyboard player and sometimes an extra guitar player who could sing and help out with some of the backing vocals. The inherent problems here are that there's no focal point frontman anymore. Steve, however brilliant a singer he is, it's not a centre stage thing. It's, you know, the suite always had a centre stage person. I did my best vocally, but I'm a higher range singer. I'm not the, you know, the screamer who's out front of the band. I'm, you know, and in hindsight, a replacement would have probably been the answer, but would we have had any more success? I don't know. It's that old syndrome of trying to outguess the market as it was. I do feel, though, that we were a very good, tight band as we were, and we were used in America a lot as a wedge in the sandwich. Where there was a three-act bill, the suite would be the middle, we'd be the sandwich. You knew you were never going to get a sound check, so your gear was thrown on the stage, you'd do it, and then you were off, because there'd be the main band, someone like Alice Cooper, Kiss, Bob Seger, and there'd be an opening band who would play first. Now, they would get a sound check, and Bob Seger, earlier on in the day, would get a sound check, but the middle band, because there was never enough time to do three sound checks, would never get a sound check.
Was it hard to fall back into that role, having headlined, having... What was that? How did that feel like?
It became quite comfortable, in fact, too comfortable. To play for an hour in front of 20,000 people in a stadium gig became far too comfortable. But as we were all... We all had a discussion, I remember, after one gig, and just basically said, where are we going? We could probably have continued doing that for a number of years, as a few bands did. You know, be the important little name to help the bill out. But I think we felt that we had, a bit more to offer.
So how did the final sort of band split up? Perhaps you could date that for me too.
It was probably 81, after the tour of England that we'd done. We'd done a really successful December show, I think it was. It might have been January, at the Lyceum Ballroom before it closed. And it was such a raving gig. We also had an album to come out, but the record company, in their wisdom, didn't put it out. So we started to put some dates together around England anyway. Now, we hadn't done England properly for a number of years. So we did about 10 or 11 dates around England with no album, playing a few tracks from it, telling them, you can't buy it, but we're going to play a couple of songs from it anyway. And I thought we had a nice little tour. But the writing was on the wall. Steve Priest was now really living in America all the way down. Didn't want to come back to Europe. So it had to be something important to get his attention to come back. I think Mick was still grieving. After he had a tragedy with his wife dying a couple of years earlier, or a year earlier. And it was Steve, the management, and my thoughts that probably the best way for Mick would be to, you play the drums, let's get back out there and, you know, do it again. I just feel that however good that tour was, the writing was on the wall. I was being pushed by a few people into becoming a record producer, something that doesn't exist today, really. You know, with the band in the boxes. So I guess we just kind of ran out of road in 1981, really. And then as almost like a death row, the record company released the album, but not in England. They released it in Europe in 1982. So, and they weren't even the final mixes. Yeah, because I had run off, spent a couple of days just running off some mixes that were playable to people. Of all the tracks that we were working on, and said, I think I even wrote it on the box: "Do not use, not final mixes." And then they came out.
Do you think the band and people close to them paid a pretty high price for their success? Fame.
That would be like biting the hand that feeds, and I couldn't ever say that. I can't say that I would do things differently, even though I have probably said, "What if we'd done this?" and things like that. In hindsight, as I say, I'm kind of at peace now. So why should I want to change anything? At least I've got to an area where I'm happy, I'm doing what I love, I still play. You know, the band I've got around me are good, so.
How about others? They weren't quite so lucky. I mean, you came through it really fairly unscathed.
Apart from this bug I've got at the moment. I think you'd have to talk, and you probably will, to others about that. I can't really comment on how others have come through it, but I think rock and roll does leave a legacy.
After Sweet split, what were the 80s like for you? Did you have good points and low points?
Yeah, I certainly had a little bit of both. Post Sweet, I just immediately carried on doing what I always did: songwriting, recording. I had a few solo singles out, of which one was used for the British Rock and Pop Awards in 1983, I think it was. They used it as like a theme tune for the television. There was a point in the mid-80s when, after a stuttering, trying to get the band back together period, I ended up being in a small flat in Maida Vale in London, and needing the assistance of the government that I'd given my taxes to help me carry on. And luckily, for a number of months, they covered my outgoings. But, I came through that. You have to go down, and have to go down as far as a certain point to know about coming back up again. And I guess in the 90s, since I've pulled the band back together, I hope I won't make the same mistakes twice. I am in control of what I do now, so I don't need a manager. In fact, when I look back, all that managers have done is looked after themselves. And I hope I'm not being too harsh, but I don't see them having done what the band have had to do throughout, shall we say, the 80s, because I don't think any of us have had a brilliant time of it in the 80s. I still see them running offices, and I still see them running around in decent cars and things like that. So it's just, the Sweet are over, let's find the next one. And that's the way a management works, and it's a fact of life. You just, in the end, you come back to yourself, and you are number one, so therefore you have to look after it.
What's okay, we'll just change the tape.
Okay.
Perhaps you should explain what your present band actually is, and who's in the present band.
Yeah. Do you want to hear how it got to where it is, or do you just want to...
Briefly, yeah.
Yeah. After that mid-80s and whatever happened in the 80s, possible reformations here, possible reformations there, I pulled away from that kind of situation, because every time it's not usually the band, although if it's going to work, it's going to have to be the original four members and things like that. I just decided I need to get on with stuff here, because there were so many people ringing me up saying, come and do a gig. So there was a fairly major television show in Holland, I think it was 1990, pulled a band together to go and do it, and I'm afraid once the adrenaline and the feel for it had started, that's when the band kind of got pulled together. We've had a few personnel changes since, but the lineup at the moment, we've got a CD out called Glitz, Blitz and Hits, with this band re-recording all the old Sweet hits, which I guess a lot of people say it sounds a bit like the original band, but then if you're going to do it, you've got to do it that way. Not to fool people, but to just basically say, this is my band, this is what we do today, and yes, it does sound like the Sweet, because it does. I'm very strict on how the records and the songs should be played. There is a way to play the songs, and I make sure that they play them that way. There is a way that the drums and the bass and the guitars, they have a root, and they stick with it. The voices have a root, and they stick with it. And then it all comes together, and it sounds like the Sweet. And if you don't do it that way, then you're going to sound like any pub band saying, oh yes, I know Blockbuster. And when you hear them play it, you go, no, you don't. You know, there'd mainly be three chords or four chords in a lot of the songs. If you don't play them exactly right, then you'll just sound like anybody having a go at some Sweet material.
And you have some very direct competition, don't you, in terms of the Sweet market? I mean, there's two lots of bands called the Sweet.
Well, as I said, my band is called Andy Scott Sweet, and has been around for quite a while now. Brian has been doing some gigs, you know, he's come back. I've always maintained that you should never, why shouldn't everybody be able to do what they enjoy doing? Just because Brian and I don't want to do it together at this moment, then as far as I'm concerned, it's not really confusing. Our paths don't usually cross. We don't do the same kind of shows. We don't do the same kind of gigs. My whole reasoning behind it has been, in the 80s, I was very fortunate to get to play and work in the studio with a lot of different musicians. I won't bore you with the names, you know, because it's like a bit of backslapping. But it feeds you on, you know. There is something else. There is a life after Sweet. You know, it doesn't have to be this way. You don't have to dwell on the past. In fact, my whole motivation is always to do with the future. It's nothing to do with the past. My connection with the past is that I'll keep playing the Sweet songs from the past. But that's as far as it goes. This has not been an easy thing to do, this kind of, not interrogation, but this kind of friendly chat where you want to talk about the past, because number one, my memory isn't brilliant for it anyway. I've come away remembering far more positives. If you'd have asked me this question 10 or 15 years ago about, you know, the Sweet, I could have probably given you a lot more negatives. But, you know, times change. You know, I'm at peace, and I want it to remain that way.
What motivates you now to go on stage? What is it you want?
If there's an audience and some equipment, we'll do the gig. The motivation is that it's a complicated one. I've got musicians who now, should we say, rely upon me. So that's the business connection. We've all got to eat. We've all got to survive in this world. Number two, there's nothing better than seeing an audience really enjoying themselves to the music that they want to hear, and that's the sole motivation for continuing and playing the songs 25 years later.
What do you get out of it? Do you need it? I suppose that's what you need.
Yeah, it's far worse than any drug. I mean, I started as a player, and once you've played in front of an audience, and a few people have put their hands together, and you hear this thing called clapping, you then realise that, oh, someone actually likes what I'm doing. And then it becomes far deeper than that, because you then go through all the emotions of, oh, I can't do it anymore, and this, that, and the other, and you come the full circle all the way around. It's what I've always loved doing, and I said they're going to have to put me in a box and nail it down before I'll stop playing now.
This may not be the question you want to answer, but are you distressed when you see the condition of Brian now?
I can't answer that question. I'm extremely distressed, but it's not really a comment that... It's very, very difficult. I try and remember him as the guy that he was.
You don't think you'll ever get back together again with the original members of Sweet?
That word never is a hell of a word. The intriguing thing is Steve Priest played with my band a couple of weekends ago, and it was mighty fine. It was really good. So to actually say never would be really stupid, because there's nothing within and no motivation to say never. It's just that I'm happy doing what I do. There's no reason for me to stop doing what I'm doing. A Sweet reunion would be intriguing, but a Sweet reformation, to do this day in, day out, a little more difficult.
It's a question I'm asking everybody. Do you remember the first verse of Blockbuster, the lyrics?
Yeah.
What are they?
You better beware, you better take care, you better watch out if you've got long black hair.
Thanks. I think we're done. Gwyneth, can you think of anything we haven't covered? Good.
And we're running.
We're running.
Good.
And I'm just ask you where you're living and where you base yourself and what your sort of situation is here.
Well, it's almost a cliche, but I'm a stone's throw from Stonehenge. So it's very Spinal Tap where I live. Somewhere in Wiltshire, got a few celebs around me, people like Sting and Toya Wilcox and stuff. I've got my wife, Madeline, got a dog, Dylan, the boxer who you met. In fact, he tried to eat your microphones earlier, I think. My son is about to come down, he works with me. My son Damien, and it's actually quite idyllic, especially on a hot day like this.
Just stop you there.
I'm going to filling up again, and we're ready. House include. Okay.
Good. Same again. What's your present situation here, where you live, and what your status is here?
I live about a stone's throw from Stonehenge. I know that's a musical cliche, but that's the facts. It's very, very Spinal Tap. Few other celebs live around here. We've got Sting and Toya Wilcox, to name a couple. I live here with my wife, Madeline, and our boxer dog, Dylan. I think he tried to eat your microphones earlier, so you've met him. My son is actually on his way down here, but I don't think he's going to make it for this. He still works with me, and he goes to musical college. That's my son from my first marriage, that's Damien. He's about 24 this year. And my status in the community, I think I've blended in quite well. I don't really want to go back to living in London because I love Wiltshire and I love this area, especially on a day like this.
Thanks. tell us what you're up to in terms of music, but you're still obviously working in that field and doing original stuff.
Well, Andy Scott's Sweet has now had two albums out, and what we've done is we've repackaged a few things so that for the first time, Andy Scott Sweet is actually going to have a boxed set. I can't believe that, you know, from Little Acorns, eh?
Perhaps we could go to this track now, perhaps you've introduced that as some music you've been making.
This is an excerpt from a song that was, it's actually been on two albums now. This is an instrumental version of the song. This is a song called Natural. It was actually written for my wife, Madeline. The lyrical version was, but this is the part of the instrumental section in the middle. It's actually quite classical in its connotation.
Enough? I'm afraid the dog wants to be in the shade.
And if you look towards us now, right into the camera. Yeah. You've got that one.
Done?
Not quite.
Almost.
Stand again, please.